here's what happens, right? So you go work events, and you meet great people, Cutco owners, new customers. You sell them. They become customers. And sometimes what people do is the buck stops there. And what you'll find is that when you talk to the best people in the business, the Curtis JQs, the Luke Mills, the Brian Carters, the Jason Jeffries, the Kareem Eltawanzis, the Leah Eliopoulos's, the Deanna Scortinos, the Brandon Browns, the Seth Kinzers, the Matt Fosses, when you talk to anybody about what they're doing behind the scenes, what you'll realize is that much of their success at the booth is not just coming from selling at the booth. That is a big component of it. But it's also coming from consistently communicating with and following up with their existing clients and marketing to those people long term. And so my entire business has been built on marketing. And I remember years ago when I was thinking to myself, like, okay, I remember the first year I did 46 events in a year. 46 events, I went on the rep trip, and three of those events were two weekends. So that means that I basically worked 49 weekends out of the year. I had one weekend where I went home to see my family in Michigan to like visit and like decompress. I had one weekend where Amy and I went out on the rep trip. And that was my year. And it was a freaking crazy year. It was awesome. I met a lot of new people. I worked a lot of great events. I built my customer base up. But the big question in my head at the end of the year was, why the heck am I working so hard doing this? And it was a year where I had to really think about, what is my long-term strategy here? What am I really actually trying to accomplish through my business? And it's where I really started to sit down and design like the idea, which for me at the time, my mission was, I want to build a customer base of over 10,000 clients who feel consistently served by me and who are very loyal to me. All over the country, people that when they think Cutco, they think not just Cutco, they think Cutco Josh, right? And I came up with, you know, how do I do that? How do I actually make that happen? How do I get out there and actually build loyalty? How do I get less people to buy from me and then go buy from somebody else? How do I make sure that when people need service, they pick up the phone and call me, or they hop on their computer and email me? And over the course of the last multiple years, I would say that my 10,000 customers have consistently been the sacrificial lambs on the altar of figuring out the marketing strategy that best works for, you know, getting repeat business year after year after year. But what I'm excited about is that with the strategy that we've created that I use in my business, and I would love to personally teach you guys today, Amy and I have been able to build a system and a strategy into our business that's put us in a place where now that we have over almost 10,000 clients, we're actually able to consistently create a few $100,000 a year in business just by staying in touch with those people and using strategy, like intentionally designed strategy to maximize our opportunity with customers. You know, if we want to fill a week with service calls, we can do that. If we want to drive, if I'm working at a booth and I want my past customers in that area to come to the booth, we make sure that that happens. And it's all about strategy. So I want to share with you guys today just what I call the six steps of building clients for life. The goal, really, with clients for life is to actually earn lifelong loyalty from our clients. I mean, here's the way I think about it. What the hell are you working so hard for if you're not working hard to build a lifestyle? And here's what's great about Cutco. Our product lasts forever. Our product and our service is best in class. Yes or yes, Cutco reps? Our product is best in class. Yes or yes?
Yes.
Yeah, and we back it up with a best in class service. Yes or yes?
Yes?
Isn't that awesome to know that you represent that? Here's what's beautiful about that. In this business, when you work Cutco events or whatever you do in our business, whether you work the business gift program or you work the realtor program or you do service calls or your bread and butter is demos, it doesn't matter who you are. You can build a lifelong lasting business by taking care of your clients, by making sure that your clients feel served at the highest level, by staying in touch with your clients. And what you're actually able to do is build a book of business that in the long run results in consistent repeat business from your clients. It's a pretty amazing opportunity. How many of you guys are already benefiting from this opportunity? Raise your hand. Look around the room. Raise your hand. Keep them up high, guys. It's all the top CSPs in the room. You know, Seth Kinzer, I know, sold $150,000 last year in repeat business to his past customers, much of which was at shows. that he was already going to be working anyways. Seth, what's your best show ever? Minnesota State Fair. How many days did you work this year? 12 days. How much did you sell? $60,000 in 12 days. It's an average of $5,000 a day. How much of that was past customer business? Half. Half of it was past customer business. So I know in the Texoma State Fair team this year, we did 3 state fairs. Our entire team marketed to their customers, followed the strategy I'm going to share with you guys today, one of the strategies, and we did over $1 million in 46 days. $250,000 of that was repeat business. 25% of our sales, $250,000 in repeat business. Because of our ROR program, 85,000 of that, 25% of our repeat business was written up for other reps by other reps with zero complaints the entire fair season. Zero complaints the entire fair season. All because, but it all started with our commitment as a team to consistent quality communication with our clients. So I want to share with you guys today the 6 steps to actually building. I want to share with you the grand strategy that we're really working within right now. And we'll deep dive into actually defining your brand, helping you understand what is your value statement to your clients, and how do you capture leads in a way and communicate with those leads in a way that aligns you with that brand. That's the goal of the message today. So let's dive right in. So grand strategy is really simple. Number one, it's to serve first. In today's world, any of the sales books that you read, any of the sales training that you do outside of our business, anybody that you talk to who's a long-term, sustainable, successful sales rep will tell you, service first, sales second. We gotta serve the clients first. Right, there's a lot of people out there that you can tell when someone has commission breath. You can tell when all they care about is the sale. How many of you guys have run into salespeople where this is the case? Like all they care about is the sale. How many of you enjoy working with those people and will work with them more and more in the future? Raise your hand. Nobody? Cool. Don't be that sales rep to your customers. You've got to be about service first. Then promote. If you want marketing to work for you, you've got to ask yourself, how am I serving my clients? How am I delivering that service to my clients? How am I making sure that my clients know and feel served throughout their entire, you know, experience with not just Cutco, but with me as their Cutco person? And then, how am I promoting myself? How am I setting myself up so that they know consistently what I'm doing, where I'm doing it, how I'm doing it, and what I want them to do with that information? Do your customers know when you're out doing service calls, if that's what you do in your business? Do your customers know how to get their knives serviced based on the way you provide service in your business? Do your customers know when you're out doing events? Do they know when you're having sales? How are you making sure that when you've got stuff going on, they know about it? And then third, sell. Ultimately, in the end, if we serve our clients at the highest level and we promote our stuff, what's great is that when you're promoting and serving, when you're serving first, promoting second, what ends up happening is because you're serving at such a high level, then when you promote yourself, more people show up, more people call you, more people email you, more people come to your events, and then, of course, when those people show up, you got to be in a position where you're ready to sell. How many of you guys in this room, how many of you ladies in this room, are sales weapons right now? Like, you know, put a customer in front of me and they're a qualified prospect, I am going to close a deal. Raise your hand. If you're like super confident in your ability to close deals and sell right now, can I hear you say, I'm a selling machine? That's right. Say it again. I'm a selling machine. Right. That's right. You guys are. You're like the Cutco army. Those of you who are not saying that right now, work on your scripts. Go cross train. Take what you learned yesterday, actually implement that information. And most importantly, believe in yourself more than you do right now. Make that choice right now to believe in yourself more than you currently do. Because I got news for you. The fact that you're in this room right now means that you're already a selling machine. Means that you're already a weaponized Cutco sales rep. You're already part of the top 1 or 2% of people to come through. That's why you're here right now. So give yourself a little bit of credit. We are our own toughest critics, right? Could you do better? Of course. I can get better. Everybody in this room, the reason you're here is because you feel like you could get better. Sometimes we just need to believe in ourselves a little bit more than we already do. So let's talk about the 6 steps. 6 steps to executing a best-in-class marketing strategy. When you get these 6 steps working for you in your business, you'll be amazed at the difference that they can make for you. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you a question, a quality question you need to ask yourself at each of these 6 steps. It's the most important question to answer for each of these 6 steps. When you get these answers right and you do the work to get them implemented into your business, you'll be amazed at what you can accomplish. So step number 1, your brand. What is your brand? Who are you? What is the service that you offer to your clients, and how do you deliver that service? What is your brand, and how do you deliver that brand? How do you align with that brand? You must know this. You know, Tom Coates, where are you at? You in here right now? Tom, right there. So Tom's great because he came up to me last year after the net meeting. He's like, or one of our conferences, boot camp or the CSP event, I can't remember where, but we had a great discussion. And he was like, hey, man, I'm a trained chef. And I want to build a brand. He's like, tell me what you think of this. I want to build a brand where I'm consistently putting videos in front of my customers where I'm not just teaching, like, I don't want to just teach them Cutco. I want to teach them knife skills, and I want to teach them cooking skills, and I want to teach them how to cut foods. I want to actually deliver them value above and beyond just the Cutco experience. What do you think? I said, that's great. The more you can align with who you are and what value you bring to your customers above and beyond just selling them Cutco, the better you'll do. The more loyalty you'll build with your clients. And as a result, the more they'll shop with you when you start promoting yourself and when you become a weaponized sales machine in this business. And that's what he does now. That's what he does, consistently puts out videos. You know, Jason has his knife of the month that he does. Jason Jeffrey, every month his clients receive. Like when they buy from him, he's got something like 25 videos or something like that he's recorded about all the knives and how to use them. And he does his knife of the month thing. Every month, his client, or every time a client buys from him, they go on a drip, and every month they get a new video for like 2 years straight that is teaching them how to use their knives. Right? In my business, it's about, I want my clients to always feel served. Now, I don't do as many service calls anymore, so the way we provide service to our clients is I'll connect them with a service rep in their area, or if we don't have anybody that can see them at any given time, we'll help them get their knives sent back to the factory, get them the instructions, make it super easy, follow up with them consistently. But it's because I'm clear on who I am and what my brand is and how I deliver that brand to my clients, that I'm able to align with that and become congruent with that and then deliver. And if you can define your brand clearly, how you stand out from the crowd, and then communicate that to your clients effectively and follow through, set up your business in a way where you follow through on that, you'll earn their loyalty right out the gates. So, second step is your relationships. Your relationships with your clients. What are you doing to consistently communicate with your clients through value-added relationship building? Write that down. That's the quality question. What are you doing to consistently communicate with your clients through value-added relationship building? Are you sending thank you cards? Are you sending confirmation emails? Are you doing follow-up calls to check in? Are you offering service to your clients? Do you know your clients' birthdays? What do you do that's special for your best clients? How do you even segment your best clients and define who they are? What is a best client for you? Do they deserve something special? All of these things are relationship building questions you should be asking in your business and answering in your business. Because here's the thing, when you know your brand and you deliver that brand consistently, and then you consistently communicate in a quality way with your clients, from the perspective of just building a relationship, sharing what's going on for you, you know, how many of you, a client bought from you because you were in a big contest, a big push week, you were trying to break a record, you were trying to win some prize, you were trying to win a trip, you were trying to do something really special, and you shared your goals, and your clients bought from you as a result of that? Raise your hand if this has ever happened in your business. Great. How many of you, keep your hands up, if your clients consistently know whether or not you achieved that goal, whether or not you won that prize, whether or not they actually helped you or not? Look around the room. The best reps in the room are the ones with their hands up still. Don't you think they want to know? Right? By the way, it took me 10 years to figure this one out. 10 stinking years. I finally had a customer call me. She's like, Josh, you know what? I buy from you every Christmas because of the big goal that you're going for, but I never know. Did you hit the goal? I bought from you like 10 years in a row, and I never knew. Like, you've never told me. Did you hit your goal? Did you get your prize? And I'm like, oh, my God. And then one of the best emails I send out every year is our update email, like our year in review email, where we tell them about all the records we broke or all the prizes that we won. Or it doesn't have to be all the stuff. It can just be one thing. It could be that you bought the house. It could be that you won the trip. It can be simple. But you got to communicate, and that's relationship building right there. It's that personal connection. You know, how many of you have gotten engaged in the last year? Raise your hand. Yeah? How many of you have let your customers know that you got engaged? Don't you think they'd want to celebrate that with you? They want to know when you're buying houses. They want to know when you're going on trips. So, all right, third step, your promotions. When you're building relationships consistently with your clients through value-added communication, what's great is then you can promote yourself. And when you promote yourself, people will pay more attention. More people will pay attention because you're building relationships with them. Because you're building relationships with them, they'll pay more attention. So how are you strategically promoting the stuff that you're doing? Specifically with events, how are you promoting your events? What events are you promoting this year? How often are you promoting your events? You know, for me, if I'm going to an area where I have a big customer base, I'm promoting that. I want them to know I'm going to be there because I want to drive them to the event. If I'm running a big sale, I want them to know I'm running a big sale so I can drive them to that sale. How are you promoting? Second or fourth step is your follow-up. Your follow-up. Everything shows the fruit is in the what? The fruit is in the what? Exactly. The fruit is in the follow-up. If you're promoting yourself but you're not following up with your clients, you're leaving a lot of business on the table. Right? I have a lot of clients that, you know, what we do, for example, is when we, which we'll talk about driving traffic to events here in a minute, but what we do is anytime we run a promotion, we follow up almost any time, not every time, but almost any time that we run a promotion, especially if it's a big client base in an area where we do a lot of business, anytime that we run a promotion, whether it's an event promotion or a sale or a service promotion, we're following up with the people who got that promotion just to remind them that they got that promotion, just to see if they need any service, see if they have any questions. And it's amazing because more people show up because we did the follow-up. I have a lot of clients. Like, I had a lady who bought from me during a sale I ran in April last year. It was like, hey, I'm doing this big event. I'm also going to run the sale, da, 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 da. And then I saw that this lady, you know, clicked on my email, and I called her, and she's like, oh, yeah, you know, I've been meaning to call you, but I keep forgetting. I keep getting busy. I keep getting distracted, whatever. I need a gift set. And then she was like, you know what? This is the first time you've ever, like, actually called me while you're running a sale. You should call me more often because I'll probably buy from you every time. And I was like, great advice. Put that one on the calendar, right? Next sale is in December. All right, sweet. What's funny is that while I was on the phone with her, I also executed all the other sales strategies that we know as weaponized sales machines, like upserving, right, asking quality questions. And that one gift set turned into three gift sets, and that three gift sets turned into five, and then she called me back the next day and bought two more. So like suddenly that one gift set order, had I not called that, she would have kept forgetting and forgetting and forgetting and forgetting and probably never called me because the sale would have expired and been like, oh well, I missed it. That one gift set that she was planning on buying turned into from a $150 order to a $1,000 order just because I followed up with her, right? We have people who show up at our events where they're like, the only reason I'm here is because you called me. I got your email, got your postcard, and then you called me. I mean, what do you expect? Of course I'm here. I'm like, cool. All I need is a qualified prospect, which any past customer of yours who's already done business with you, are they qualified or are they unqualified? They're qualified, right? Absolutely. So it just makes sense to put them in front of you because once you're there, here we go. Game on, right? So I agree with Deanna and Brandon, everybody that shared yesterday. Once you have the credit card in hand, game on. The other next level think that I have is once a past customer's in front of me, game on, game on. It's like, let's go, because I know you're already sold. I know you're already served, because that's what we're on a mission to do for you. Fifth thing is your system. Your system. You get to a point in this business where you have hundreds of customers, And that can feel overwhelming sometimes. Then you get to a point where you have thousands of customers. Trust me when I say you want to build the system now. If I could go back and do everything over again, the number one thing I would do differently is I would have gotten my CRM earlier. I would have built all my email templates earlier. I would have done all this communication stuff earlier through a systemized approach. Because I think back, like, I didn't actually start using a database until I had over 5,000 clients. I think about the number of cracks and things that slipped through those cracks, not having a CRM, not having not outsourcing my marketing, not actually like letting the professionals handle it for me. And I realized, like, holy crap, there's a lot of relationships I left on the table that could be strong, loyal relationships right now that just aren't, because they just weren't part of the system. So what's your system that allows you to operate at scale? You should be thinking about that now. How are you organizing your clients? What information do you want to keep on your clients? And I'm not going to talk a lot about this because Amy's coming up in a few minutes to tell you about how to make your systems work for you. And she is a systems ninja. She's the only reason that I am so systemized, because I recruited her a few years back. It's one of the best sales I ever made, was leave your corporate job and come work for us for free. I don't know how she did it, but she did it, and we doubled our business almost in a year. So she's a systems meister. It's amazing. She's going to come up and talk about that. And then the sixth step is your visibility. Your visibility. You know, you can have all of this stuff in place. You can have your brand and be congruently aligned with it. You can have that clearly defined. You can be building relationships consistently. You can be promoting yourself consistently. You can be following up consistently. You can have the system in place. But if you're not paying attention to your results, if you're not creating a high level of visibility by tracking your statistics, Matthew Kelly says, what we don't grow, we can't move, or something like that. That's like my own way of saying it. But you can't move the mark if you don't actually, or I'm sorry, you can't grow what you don't measure. That's what it is. If you don't measure it, you can't grow it, right? You have to start by measuring things. You know, when you send an email out, you may not get the same results I get. And that's okay. What matters is that you're paying attention and that you're asking yourself the question, or you're asking your marketing team the question of, how do we improve now? What did we learn from this? How do we improve? But if you don't even measure the results, if you don't know how many opens or clicks you're getting, if you don't know how many calls you made to follow up on your postcard, if you don't even know how many postcards you sent out or how many letters you sent out, if you don't even know how many people actually showed up as a result of sending those letters out, it's kind of hard to move the needle on your marketing because you're not measuring your results. So how are you measuring your results? You've got to create visibility in your business. It's what any good business owner will do. We're not perfect at it. There's still plenty of stuff where Amy and I are like, what's the answer to this question? We want to know this result. And we're like, oh, we didn't track that one. Crap, maybe we should track that moving forward. So it's not about being perfect at it. It's about making progress with it. But trust me, when you start to look at your numbers, you can then start to influence those numbers. It's how I learned that, hey, when we promote an event and all we're promoting is the Cutco booth and sales, we're not really getting a big open rate. So we made a shift. We said, let's focus on promoting the event and the value of the event and then make the Cutco thing an oh, by the way, at the end of the email. And suddenly, more people started showing up. Our conversion rates went higher. More people showed up as a result. And the more people showed up, the more sales I was able to get. I was like, oh, that was a big win. We should probably make sure that every time we promote an event, we promote it that way instead of the other way. Right? Boom. And then we were like, oh, what if we actually call all the people that we promoted the event to? And we called everybody. And it was, woof, there it went. What if we actually did a drawing for our customers to come by the booth? So there's no purchase necessary, just come by the booth, put your name in a drawing. Boom, more people showed up. But we only knew those things. We only were able to ask those questions because we were looking at the results and saying, how do we make this better? Right? And then you can create strategy. And you know what? There's been many strategies where they sucked. They were doozies. They didn't work. We spent money on them. And it was a loss. Right? But I don't look at my marketing strategy as like this one and done thing. It's an annual strategy. It's like, how much did we spend this year? How much time did it take to execute? What did we learn from it? And how much did we sell? What was the profit on that? And can we increase that profit by doing something better? What do we continue doing? What do we stop doing? Don't do things that aren't profitable for your business, plain and simple. So now let's talk about building the brand. I want to give you the three pieces to building a brand here. And then your handout, I don't know if the handout went out. Oh, it looks like it did. All right, your handout, we don't have time to actually answer these questions. But the challenge I want to give you guys today is that you take the time to walk through these questions today. at some point. Maybe it's during lunch. Maybe it's tonight before you go out and party with everybody, right? Maybe it's you know, tomorrow night on the plane. Whatever it is, but take the time to actually answer these questions. I'm going to share with you my service statement to my clients, who I am, what I deliver to my clients. And I'm going to encourage you not to duplicate it. I mean, duplicate it if it's exactly who you are and your brand that you want to promote to your clients. But what's better for you to do is go through and answer these questions for yourself. Because by answering these questions is how I came up with my brand, and I was able to deliver that to my clients. But the first thing is confidence. You've got to have confidence in yourself that what you're delivering is actually what you want to deliver to your clients. That what you're telling your clients is actually what you're excited about doing 4, 5, 10 years from now. And the only way you figure that out is to actually answer these types of questions and get real clear on who you are and how you deliver. Second thing is congruence. What's great is when you have confidence in your brand, then it becomes really easy to set up your business and systemize your business in a way where you're fully congruent with what you actually want to provide. You know, what happened for me, a big mistake I made, was I built up big customer bases in multiple states across the country as we moved around, and the whole time I'm like, yeah, I'll come out to your house, sharpen your knives for free every 2 to 3 years. Yeah, thousands of customers. Guess what? When you do that with thousands of people across the country, it's tough to follow through on that brand. It's tough to deliver that service. We've had to work very diligently over the last few years to tweak our customers' expectations. Because the reality is when you have 10,000 clients that are in 49 states all across the country and that's what you've been telling them, which that's not what everybody expects now, but there are a group of people that expected that, it's hard to deliver that service to them. So we've had to readjust their expectations to let them know, like, hey, listen, if we don't have a service rep in your area, we'll just help you get it sent back to the factory. It's a better service anyways. And now people are doing that, and they love it because we're fully congruent. But for a while there, I wasn't fully congruent because I hadn't done the work on this, right? So you got to answer these questions. And the third thing is capturing. Here's the great thing. When you're fully confident in who you are, how you deliver service, what your customers get from you in terms of value, and then you're set up in a way where your communication and what you're articulating to your clients and sharing with your clients is fully congruent with that brand, then you just got to start capturing as many leads as you possibly can. I want to give you guys a little golden weapon that I've been using for the past couple years. It's been amazing. It's how I've taken people who came to me at the booth, right? I did a demo for them, and they didn't buy anything, but some of them 2, 3, some of them 5, 6, some of them 10 years later, when I run some form of a promotion through my marketing strategy, eventually I get the call. Or when I promote an event and tell them to come to the event, eventually they come to the event. Like that Deanna story that she shared yesterday about the guy that she demoed 2 years before who couldn't buy, right, and waited for her for 30 minutes instead of talking to somebody else. This is how you get those people. You confidently explain who you are and the brand that you do. And you set your system up to congruently align and provide that to your clients. And then you capture their information. So what I do is every person that I spend time doing a demo for, if they don't buy, not everybody does, it's okay, maybe it's bad timing, I get their info. Sometimes it's Cutco owners, right? And they just need their knives serviced. But they're not interested in seeing more Cutco now. Okay, cool, let me get your information. We'll send you the information on how to get them serviced, or we'll come out to your home if you're in an area we service, right? I get their information, name, email, zip code. How many of you are using Vast Action CRM? Raise your hand. Great. The secret thing you need in your CRM for every lead, no matter what, every referral you get, every lead you get at the booth is the zip code, right? Because in the CRM, you can query by the zip code. If I'm in, you know, Drew's town tomorrow doing service calls and I've got a couple gaps, I open up my CRM, I run a quick query, say, give me everybody I've got that's a service lead or a referral or whatever that's within 10 miles of this zip code that I'm in right now. Google Maps is amazing. You just open up your phone, click on something near you, it tells you the zip code, right, of that place. You go in, run a query, and then boom, I have a call list. I can start making calls in a matter of seconds. That's how I won my first Silver Cup, was having that system in place. So I could quickly make calls and fill in gaps throughout the day. If I couldn't fill in my appointment gaps, I would call my past customers, my best customers. I had wish lists on file, and I'd get orders from them while I was between appointments using the system, leveraging it, right? But first, you got to get the leads. So what I do, everybody that does not buy from me, whether they're a Cutco owner and needs service, I'll send them the factory instructions, follow up with them, do a service call, whatever makes most sense based on who they are, where they are, and how we deliver service in their area. If they're a demo, I get their information. Hey, you know what? Like, one of the worst mistakes we can make as salespeople is when we realize that that person that we're demoing, we just spent time with, you just did an amazing, best-in-class sales presentation, right? They're totally interested and engaged. They're a prospect. That's why you spent so much time with them. They answered all the questions the right way, but the timing's bad, so they're not going to buy today for some reason or another, and then you let your energy change. Suddenly you're like, well, you suck now. I don't want to spend any more time with you. So see you later, shoe fly shoe, right? I'm guilty of this. It's one of my Achilles heels I have to pay very close attention to when I'm with the clients. How many of you have ever had this happen to you before? Yeah, right? We're all guilty of it, especially after a long, stressful day where we got big goals and we're going after big stuff and people just aren't buying for some reason, right? Well, here's the deal. Take it to the master level, and with that person, you just say, hey, you know what, Josh? I get it. It seems like the timing's just not right. But I can tell you really like Cutco. Is this something you're eventually going to get for sure? Great, I would love to be the person that takes care of you when that time comes. So is it cool with you if I get your information, just stay in touch with you? Because I think we had a really great time here. And trust me, man, when you're ready to buy it, I'm going to take care of you for a lifetime. Would you be cool with that?
Yeah.
Great, cool. Now here's the deal, man. What I do for my clients is, you know, I don't bombard you with a bunch of spam and stuff like that. Instead, I send you an email once a month. It has a featured product of the month and a recipe in it, so you can, like, stay in tune with Cutco. By the way, it's not Cutco specific. Like, you can use it with any knives in your kitchen, right? But it's just to help you get better use out of your kitchen stuff and give you a cool recipe to try out with it. So check that out, because I think you'll enjoy it. And here's the thing. I might run a sale or two a couple times a year. I don't blast you every day with sales, because that's annoying, right? All right, great. So once or twice a year, if I have a big sale, I'll let you know. That way, when you're ready, you can let me know, and I'll get you taken care of. Is that cool? All right, great. And it's only because you spend time with me today that I want to keep in touch with you, and you were really cool about this. So, dude, here, fill this out. Just put down your name, your email, your phone number. You can put in your address if you want a catalog in the future. Definitely put your zip code so that I know where you're at if you ever reach out to me. Is that cool?
Yep.
Great. And I capture every single one of those people. Boom, boom, boom. Right? Boom, boom, boom. Now, if you're a weaponized sales machine, most people you talk to will buy from you, yes or yes? Yeah, absolutely, but there's still those few extra people every single event that you could get in your database and stay in touch with. And trust me, I had a guy call me this Christmas who he had met me at a show 6 years ago. And as a result of meeting me at that show and me saying that to him and then staying in touch with him, actually following through on that, simple delivery of the brand, he called me up this Christmas and bought a signature set with steak knives. Added on a couple extra $100 worth of gifts. And I would have never gotten that if I'd have treated them differently, right? So the idea is capture your leads. See them as potential future business. Treat them just as good as you would treat a person who did buy from you and put them in your system. Put them in your system, stay in touch with them, consistently communicate with them, and execute this marketing strategy. And if you want help building this marketing strategy, if you want to do it yourself, that's awesome. Do it. Let us know the questions that you have. You want to outsource and get people to help you? Come talk to us about that. We can support you with that. That's our goal, right? But do whatever's best for your business. We're just here to support you. So execute this strategy. It's about the six steps. It's about asking yourself quality questions about your business. And it starts with defining your brand clearly. The reason I'm giving you this today is because I find most conversations I have, when we start here, most people haven't done this work. So that's why I wanted to give this to you today, so you can work on these questions, get really clear on it. If you have follow-up questions, follow up with me. You all have my information. You know how to get a hold of me. So that's it. So we're going to move on to the next. That's funny because I deleted these slides earlier, but they got back in there for some reason. Now we're going to bring up our next speaker.